The place I lived at North First, I was convinced I had a house. I was sitting in the living room one night. I looked out on the hall, and the light in the ceiling fell into the ceiling. And it didn't just fall down. It floated down. It was a weird experience. It floated down and ended up on the floor. It was a glow. It was a glow.
When you looked down, she was zeroed in, looking at the basement window of the night. Years later, I watched a master call to the police call. After she said, you didn't have any of that. I watched a master call to the police and I was out there. I told her,
you met a lot of
things.
Wonderful. You've got to see it. It's so beautiful.
It's charming.
Grown up entertainment.
If you can play this on your TV, I don't even know how to open the box. Produced by Lee Bowden, 1977.
77.
Total running time, 14 minutes.
In 1662, on the south bank of the Mohawk River, Dutch settlers built a stockade around their newest outpost, which the Indians called Schenectady. The French and Indian Wars brought fire and massacre in 1690, but the colonists rebuilt their town. It grew and spread from the riverfront settlement, but the homes in that core have been lived in continuously through three centuries. In the 1800s, Schenectady's water link expanded with the Erie Canal. Minor annual flooding continues to be a prepared for adversity, bringing people together in mutual aid. The current stockade community began evolving in the 1930s, when, as elsewhere, the threat of demolition faced some neglected houses in Schenectady's civic birthplace.
Memories of growing up on North Street. I was born in an upstairs room in a house on North Street. For me, there is a lifetime of memories here in that house and on that street. When I was very young, it was paved with cobblestones and was home to a very ethnic community with about 90% of the residents being Polish. For the most part, our little street was one big happy family. Of course, there were family dramas and tragedies, but even though people had very little, they helped each other when necessary. I hope my little trip down memory lane, North Street in the stockade, held something of interest for you. Oh yes, by the way, I still live here. My name is Jesse Malecki, and I lived in this house for 90 years.
I'm Peter C. Hornby, and I've lived in this area since my birth. I was born in 1926, originally was born in Scotia, New York, and moved over to Schenectady in this area in 1932. This house we're in now in 21 was built in 1911 by my grandmother and grandfather because she wanted a nice new place.
Well, I came from a family of 9 children. And of course, there was a span of 20 years from the oldest to the youngest. So we lived in a flat like this downstairs. Can you imagine that? The way people have now, they have to have a family room. They got to have this room. And there were 9 children down there and 2 parents.
Oh, our family, the Schneiderwins, came here in 1842, and
there were several families that came from Hilda, Germany at that time. Nikolaus family, Debbie's family was Nikolaus, and they also had a butcher shop that was down across from the Indian, near Arthur's. And then they were also the Schwenker family and the Whitmire, the broom factory. William Schneiderwin, who was my great-great-grandfather, the broom maker.
I asked your father one time, I said, do you remember when I was born? Because I had four brothers and his father was the second oldest. And he says, oh yeah. I says, tell me about it. He says, well, one day your father said, we were out playing, or outside, so he said, come on in here. And he showed me to him. He says, this is your new sister. He didn't even know he was going to have another. I think your family and my family were the only Italian ones right. On Green Street.
Yes, I'm Polish.
There was a Polish member of the Dobies family.
Lawrence, Mr. Lawrence.
Lawrence, oh, that's right, yeah.
Matilda.
Yeah.
Remember Matilda?
Yeah.
She was smart. Matilda was a smart girl.
And she was so terribly upset about living in Escuna. She wanted to be in place where there are people. I said, all right, we're going to move. Yeah. And put the house on sale. I got an apartment down here at 22 North Street. The first floor apartment was, there were four of us. We squeezed in there. We had plenty of furniture for that. But the toilet was in a closet, all stand alone. They had to wash their hands in the sink, and it was really quite marginal for four people.
Hi there, I'm Joe Fava, or Joseph Fava, and I'm sitting here on the stage of the Schenectady Civic Players. It's a organization that has been here since 1926, but we have been in this location for 86 years, going into our 87th year. We've always been sort of part of the stockade, which is really nice because we get a lot of people that obviously come in from the stockade to see our show.
Yes, well, I am Jean Sager, and I have lived here for over 50 years. My children grew up here. They went to the local school, walked to school, came back for lunch. There was so much enhancing their lives that today they think this place, despite their wide travels, as unique. And they just love coming back here. It's so special. It's here we are, close to a city with all that a city has to offer. And yet we have places here that are quiet and natural.
The first time I saw the stockade was in 1951. My father had retired from the Navy and come to live in Schenectady and work for General Electric. And I was living in California with my husband and one child. And I was curious, so when my husband was sent to Newport for 3 months, I decided to come with him and take a look at Schenectady and see how my parents were doing as civilians. Yeah. And so I saw the stockade, came to St. George's, and fell in love with it just the way the rest of my family did. Yeah. And then I came back again it was 1953, my husband went to Korea for 13 months. And it was the Korean War, so of course I couldn't go along. So I came back again and stayed with my parents. By that time I had two little girls. And it was a wonderful place to be because not only did I have the support of my family, my parents, but it's, you know, the stockade's like a village. And I had St. George's Church, which was very important. And then in 1961, my husband was deployed again for 13 months, and I came back again. And at that time, my two older girls were in school. I had three little girls by that time. My two older girls were in school, and they came here to Riverside School. and spent that year here. And then in 1966, my husband retired from the Marine Corps. And he'd been brought up in the Army, and I'd been brought up in the Navy. And neither one of us had a real home. We didn't have roots anywhere. So Schenectady, by that time, seemed almost more like home than any place we'd ever lived.
Yeah, I'm Malcolm Willison. I've lived in the Stockade only since 1984, which is, by the Stockade standards, yesterday, and sometimes feels like yesterday to me. We tried to live in the Stockade for many years, because I first came to Schenectady in 1964, and couldn't find any place to rent. So finally, we were ready to buy a house. Weren't shown anything in the Stockade, and we asked Werner and Jim, Werner Fivers and Jim Schmidt, friends of ours, whether there was anything in the Stockade, and they said, oh sure, there's a house right next door that the divorced wife of the famous city judge who used to drink a lot and get into trouble, Diddy Quinn, was about to sell. She hadn't put it on the market yet, so we rushed in and loved it. I saw it from the street, and it's a huge old Victorian townhouse. Really hideous on the outside, with a big bay window, and it dominates all the other houses because it's so big. But we bought it because it was perfect for what we needed. A mother-in-law downstairs and we upstairs. And then that's how we became citizens of the Stockade.
We fled Germany in December of 1938 from Hitler. And my dad was a pediatrician. Came to New York. And he labored for a year and a half getting prepared to take the state board so he could practice medicine. Well, he made it. So he said, well, we're not going to stay in New York City. I don't like big cities. And so they bought a car, he and my mother, and they drove around New York State. And he came up into this neighborhood and just loved the size of it and the mountains and the lakes. He also, wherever he went, he interviewed some pediatricians, and some of them were less than friendly, like, move along, buddy. Came here, and Frank Vanderbilt had a big reputation because of medicine. And so he went to see him, and he was just greeted with this tremendous warmth. And he said, oh, you must come with your background, you know, 20-some-odd years of pediatrics in Germany, and you'll love it here. Yeah, gave him a big sales pitch. He lived right around the corner. Yeah, and so, of course, that's all my dad needed, that kind of, you know. He had spent 2 weeks in a concentration camp before we came. So it was like, this is too good to be true. We came to Schenectady. But so there's sort of a history, personal history, that we came to Schenectady through the Stockade and through an old Dutch family. Just by sheer coincidence, his son became an architect. I worked for his son when I went to college, and one day my dad said, why don't you ask him whether he has any relationship to the guy that got us here?
So I was in Cincinnati trying to struggle getting a practice going, did a few jobs here and there.
Well, you come here.
And he said, will you come up and cover for me? So I said, well, you know, I'll take a look anyhow. I got off the train, started this neighborhood, never left. Oh, I was just overwhelmed with the architecture and the history and the people and its proximity to the river.
And this is 1956.
So. When we arrived in 1958, the neighborhood had actually moved from a period of decline, and it was becoming recognized as a place of importance for its history and for its architecture.
Well, the Stockade was, back when I was young, was not really very much. It started with, obviously, Warner and Jim, and Vanderbogart started the Stockade Association to try to save the neighborhood. When I was young, it was considered a real low-end kind of slum, almost, in a sense. It was not like it is today. The buildings were really not taken care of. They had torn down so many. I remember many, many buildings they tore down. Behind the Stockade Inn, there was a fabulous building that was, I believe, was where the Historic Society was originally. And it had these wonderful pointed windows, I remember. That building came down to create a parking lot for the, it wasn't the Stockade Inn then, it was the lower club, which we would call the Mohawk Club. So they tore down that building, and then of course the street, they've created many parking lots in the area. So they have torn down a lot of buildings, and I think what happened was they saw this happening, and they had a great vision, and they said, you know, we've got to stop them tearing down everything.
We realized, you know, at that time then, what we thought we had here. And it was really kind of a movement that was already rumbling. And
the New York legislature had just passed an enabling act which enabled municipalities amend their zoning ordinances with limitations on the historic district.
The people who were founders, there were two architects, a doctor, a lawyer. So these were pretty much professional people who felt the need to assure that Vernon once called it a fragile place. It could be if we did not have our voices heard.
So first thing we did was started the Stockade Association. We used to talk about the neighborhood, and he said, you know, it still is as if there was a stockade still built around it. And, you know, they didn't call it the Stockade then. It was called Old Dorp or the Village.
And the art show was formed before the association. It's called the Village's Outdoor Art Show, and that's where the term villages come from, because it was called the Village. Yeah, so certain things like that, those two things stand out as existing before, but not very much before the association.
So we said, you know, the Village is too much like New York City. They've got the Village. And let's call it the Stockade.
Well, and Bernard and Jim were very interesting, of course, people. And they'd lived in the Stockade since the late 50s and bought that house and fixed it up it's Ferry Street. And I knew everybody, very social, and they went around. So we began to give parties in this huge Victorian house. And I remember once Lavinia Van Shanklin came, along with another former friend of ours. And we were very explicit, no smoking, because my wife and I were both not asthmatic, but we were allergic to cigarette smoke. And there were Lavinia and Nancy Jonas sitting on the stairs, through the upstairs, smoking away. I was furious. I told them to stop, and they didn't, of course, because Lavinia was already in her 70s, probably, or 80s. She wasn't going to stop for anybody. And she was a grand dame. If you ever want a definition of a grand dame, she was a grand dame. And she had a sister-in-law who really was a Van Shanklin. Of course, she was a Van Shanklin by marriage. I have no idea what her maiden name was. I don't know whether she was from old Dutch family or not. But Mary van der Bogart married a Dutch descendant, obviously, Giles, for whom Werner and Jim first worked when they came to Schenectady to be architects. They became partners of Giles.
So I walked in here one day, and there was this lady, I'll never forget it, sitting at the front desk, and she said, you want to sign up? And I signed up. And she said, my name is Connie Sykes. I'll never forget her. She was a very dear person. We became very good friends. And she, not at the least of it, she had a very beautiful daughter, which actually interested me. I was like 18 years old. And she had a son. And she was a divorced woman. She lived over on Green Street, right next door to where the Bradens lived, or the Dale Miller and Zoe Oxley live right now. And through her, I met, obviously, her daughter, Carol, and next door to her were the Bradens, very, very interesting family. And Mrs. Braden was very, I guess, if it was unconventional, she never wore shoes. She used to walk around the stockade barefoot all the, in the winter yet, too, sometimes. And she used to walk down to the pool down at the Harlow's, and she'd just walk down there. It would be 5 below, she'd go swim. The pool wasn't frozen over. Mrs. Braden was in it. And they always had hours that people could go, but she never paid attention to that.
The year before we came, the Stockade Association was founded. And until that time, it was called Village. That didn't seem like a distinctive enough name, so the stockade was settled on since that fence was surrounding the area in when it was early, the early settlement.
A visual montage of stockade scenes leads us past polished doorways, while we hear varied reflections on how and why it happened from those who did the work.
Modernists look at it and say it's an A-frame. Well, that frame was there. It was built in 1746.
Well, Giles had a sister, Lavinia Shanklin, a married name, and they lived right next. They lived in the old Abraham Yates house, which is the oldest house in the stockade. But anyhow, she said, okay, let's get some people together and come to our house and talk about this idea of an association. And I thought, well, here I am. I've been here a year, and I'm a young whippersnapper, and we've got to talk to people here who have some clout, you know, who are the way...
The blue stocking.
Pardon?
The blue stocking.
Yeah, that area, that part of the stockade was called the blue stocking area.
You know, they weren't necessarily wealthy at that time in the world at that point, but there was a sense that you would know best.
Lavinia Shanklin, she's a great friend of my mother's. Dr. Blodgett lived kitty corner across from them. Elizabeth Joyce I knew well. I didn't know the Langdons. Gertrude Nalen. Jim Gilliland, Connie and Nick, Barb, the Georges, Bradbury. Oh, this is wonderful. And that was 1957. Well, people laugh when I say it. I'll say to my friends on Washington Avenue, well, I know you didn't include me in that because I live below the Indian. And they don't know what I'm talking about. But it, at a time, there was a time when it was very different. And way back, way, way back before my time, I think the people who lived here worked for the people who lived there. And I know Mrs. Parsons, the last time I checked, there was still an automobile horn in her bedroom on the third floor. That's number 21, the brownstone number 21. She had a button she pressed, and it made the noise of a car horn, an old-fashioned car horn. And her chauffeur, who lived down on Ferry, would come and bring the car. She rang the chauffeur. So there really was a difference. And when my parents moved here in the 50s, it still was in place.
And it was like night and day when you got to the Indian. that side was a different caliber of people, and this side was
a
different...
Oh, there was Udams, there was Kellogg's, there was Parsons, Vanderbilt's, or they were over farther.
You did.
I used to get $8 a week in my breakfast. And I had the key to
As a maid, yes.
And I had the key to their house. I had never been in their houses before, you know. I was and I guess in the morning, I had to be helped the cook.
No, but
the first time they had a meal, that the cook that had me help her, she was just a young girl. And, it was some kind of cream chicken and something else, and I don't know. Nothing, you know. And after it was all done and got cleaned up, I said to the cook, I said, I wish I could remember her name. I said to her, I said, the table has such beautiful glasses and dishes and silverware, sterling silver and everything. And I said, they serve that crap. I said, I could have made some spaghetti and meatballs and they would have loved it. But you know what the old doc did to me? And I was not one to speak up. I used to hold back too much. They always said, serve from the left and take from the right.
Yes.
Well, he's sitting there like this for lunch one day. I had to serve lunch. He's sitting like that. Well, I didn't know whether to say, excuse me, or so I didn't. I just served from the right. And he stood there, or he sat there and corrected me.
Really?
And I should have said to him, you shouldn't have had your elbow on the table. He never said a word. And to this day, I regret that I didn't say that. I didn't have nerve enough then. I'm afraid I wouldn't get my $8 a week. When I left Mrs. Vanderbilt's, I had applied to the GE for a job. That was right at the beginning of the war. And I got that blue envelope from the GE. All the envelopes were always in blue. Mm-hmm. And I went to tell her that I was leaving her. And I had never signed anything when she hired me. She was furious. She had a big luncheon the following week, and she needed me there. And she couldn't find a replacement. And I knew I was, you know, I couldn't turn down the GE job. And I don't know if I'd ever get hired again.
And
she's a good friend of hers was the vice president. She was going to call him up and tell him he couldn't hire me. I had to stay there and help her with lunch.
Oh, dear. Wow. So what happened?
So I said, well, go ahead. I said, but I apologize and everything. I don't think she ever called. She owed me a week, though. So the next week, I went back and rang her doorbell in front. I didn't go around the back. I rang the front doorbell. She said, just a minute. And she must have hadn't left my money downstairs, but I could see her going down. She came up and handed it to me. Oh, she was so curt and so polite to her. Not a bit friendly.
There was always something to do on the river. A lot of people had recreational boats. There was a lot of people would come through in pleasure craft and stop in Schenectady because they might have had business with a General Electric Company, which is real handy, or the American Locomotive Company, or various other industry we had in Schenectady. They liked it because they could walk from the end of Washington Avenue to State Street, which was only a few blocks, and get the benefit of stores, theater, restaurants, and various other things Schenectady's noted for. Schenectady was a canal town, and of course, it had its bistros and gambling and everything else that go with it, being a factory town, and that was the ambiance of the town. The house with blue shutters. It was in back of the fire station on Erie Boulevard on Ferry Street, and of course it was a brothel, and the man was known as Rainy King.
During my childhood, most families on North Street had rowboats so they could get to the island in the Mohawk River and plant vegetables. Of course, the boats also came in handy during the floods. When the Mohawk flooded, all of us kids had time off from school. It was fun to watch what was going on through the windows, but our parents were always worried. After the water receded, the firemen came down to pump the water out of our cellars.
Old Scotia Bridge ran from Washington Avenue over to Scotia, and it was the old covered bridge. Seven piers across there, and between each pier, they built a barn. Each one had a different roof level, like a series of barns from pier to pier. Then they had a wooden roadway that ran all the way across, and they eventually closed that because that was made of wood, and it was getting old, and people were careless with matches or something, might start a fire, and the bridge would burn.
There was a lot of fishing along the river, yeah. Sometimes it'd catch carp as big as I was, or they were pretty big fish. And we'd go over to Mastriani or one of the bakeries and get some dough. And then that was probably one of the best things to catch carp with, that or cornmeal. And we would fish along the river there, and there were some big fish pulled out of there. As a child, I thought they were pretty big.
A comment was made years ago in the 60s by the editor of a recognized magazine called the Architectural Forum. The editor said that the romantic lawn along the Mohawk that has been created out of the Stockade Park Strip is probably the finest thing of its kind in America. He said that because so often a river has a railroad running across the banks. And here you have perfect access from the neighborhood right to the riverfront and all the waterfowl and wonderful things that we enjoy year round at the river.
The city made that area a park down there, Riverside Park, and a lot of people remember that area. The park ran from the railroad bridge, which was down below Ingersoll Avenue, up to Washington Avenue, which was the upper end of it.
The park was wonderful because we had instructors there, which were paid by the city parks. And we had softball teams and crafts.
They had a swimming pool the city put in. WPA put that in, I believe. The pool was at the end of, between Ferry and Ingersoll.
Well, the park was nice. I haven't mentioned it. There was a swimming pool on North Street. Down here at the end of North Street on the left, you can still see the marks where there's a swimming pool owned by the city.
And my kids learned how to swim down there. You know, one day I came home and I went down there and I didn't know my son knew how to swim. I see him jumping in. I said, oh my God, and he's swimming away, you know.
In fact, I'll tell you, I've just thought of a very interesting story. I have a scar here, right here on my forehead. And if you've ever heard of a race car driver named Cha-Cha Muldowney, she was from Schenectady. She was the first female race car driver in the United States, and she started in Fonda. Her name was Shirley Rock. She lived across the street from, and down at the park, at Riverside Park, there was a pool. There was a big, it was a second level pool. So the building had these wonderful stone arches, and upstairs, you'd go up the stairs and the pool was up on top. So we used to swim there. Well, we were upstairs at the pool and I was chasing her. And I guess that's normal when you're young, right? So I was coming down the stairs, and if there's these stone arches, the building was all arched, and she ran around the corner, and I ran around the corner. She ran through the arch, and I was so fixed on her, I ran right into the stone wall, and I cracked my head open. And I remember this, I can't remember a lot, but I remember this very clearly. I fell backwards and, of course, passed out. And that's my scar, and there's a little bump there from Shirley Rock, who became Cha-Cha Muldowney, who became very, very famous and still is among the race car drivers of the world. I've still got her picture at home somewhere. I'm sure I could find it if I had to. of what, with, and she had pigtails, and I just was in love with the girls that had pigtails. So, so.
At the end of Governor's Lane, in the old government's mansion, was, during the war years, was taken over by a couple of professors from Union College, Harlow and Bates, and they for rooming for GE engineers coming in on test programs. A lot of famous people came through in their younger years, and it was quite the gathering spot.
It was called the University Club, and they called it, they had housing for mainly young, new young GE engineers would come in and stay there until they decided to move on. It was, they had a pool and lots of guys, and it was nice, you know.
And of course, we'd always end up in the Harlow's pool. And of course, they always had, like, you couldn't swim after a certain time, but that never made any difference to us. We would jump in there at night, and Mr. Harlow would come out with a flashlight. Arr, 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 who's in the pool? So we used to yell who we were, and he knew we were neighborhood people, so he never said much to us.
But in the old days, everybody who was anybody, including Ann Bradbury, that's how my wife met Ann Bradbury, was swimming at the Harlow's pool.
Anyhow, the first meeting was very successful, and we decided what the boundaries would be, and that there'd be a $1 each person initiation fee, and we had set up an education committee, and so we set up committees, and hammered out the bylaws, the constitution and bylaws. And we met a month later, and everybody approved all the committee's work, and we were in business. I mean, I'd only been here a year, and here we had an organization already, and I was elected president then after Copper, and then Warner designed the mastheads and all the artwork, and our secretary and he cranked out the Stockade Spy. So we went to, I don't know why we did it green, maybe that's the only ink we had at the time.
Green was just that was politically correct then as it is now.
But then we wanted to bring everybody into this idea of what an historic district was and how important it was. So it was quite a new idea, and to tell people that we're going to take some of your rights away. You know, you can own the house, but you can't do with it what you want, because it really doesn't belong to you. It's for you to use and preserve and take care of and move it on to the next generation. You can't destroy it.
Our daughter Emily decided that she wanted a donkey, and we have this big yard, huge yard, and we thought we were perfectly safe and saying, "Why, Emily, of course you could have a donkey if we lived in the country, but we live right in the middle of the city. There's no way in the world we can have a donkey." And so she didn't protest, but she went down to City Hall and read all the specs, talked to the city attorney, and he said she could have one animal so many hands high, and if it had a shed, but it had to have a cement floor. Those were the requirements, but if she met those requirements, she could have it because it would be considered a pet. So she had him put it in writing. She was about 14, I think. She came back and presented it to her father. So what could he do but go find a donkey? Well, they found a real horse trader, and the donkey they got was rather large and very stubborn. But then, before they could really take delivery on the donkey, they had to build the shed. And because the shed showed from the street, they had to go to before the Historic District Commission. And I think both Werner and Jim were on the commission at that time, because I can remember Werner very upset that we were getting, of course we didn't say it was a donkey shed, we said we were building a garden shed. And they didn't know we had to have a cement floor, we just said we had to have a garden shed. And I remember arguing with dear Werner, because he wanted me to have something quite elaborate, and almost like the house that looked like a smaller. And I can remember saying, Werner, you can't tell me that every old house down here didn't at one time or another have a shed in back of it. And we just want a simple shed. Jim and Emily had even drawn the plans. So my husband, Jim, said, well, you leave me no alternative, Werner. And Werner said, well, what is that? And he said, I'll just have to go to Sears Roebuck and get myself one of those barns, you know, those fabricated barns. Of course, we couldn't have done that because they don't have, you don't have a firm. But it was a bluff. And Werner said, well, let me see your plans again. So they okayed our plans. And Jim Lane, who lived two doors down, helped them, Emmy and Jim pour the cement. And then Emmy and Jim built the shed, which I think is still standing over there. So then we took delivery on the donkey. And they delivered him in the dark. This guy was a real horse trader, in the dark on a Saturday night. So we had to quickly, we didn't have time to call all the neighbors, you know, to warn them. And sure enough, and the first thing we knew, between the houses, we saw two policemen going down. And they had a rope, like a tow rope, you know, the rope was at least that big. And they were going down to lasso the donkey. So Emily went out and showed them the paper, and they just went off shaking their heads, you know. But I found out years later that the kids from the school here, when we weren't there, they used to go over the fence and get on her and ride her. And she was rough. She was rough. So finally, Jim and Emmy trained her to a dog. We bought a donkey cart. There was a woman selling a donkey cart. And so finally they decided they could take the donkey out on the street for a ride. And they took down a section of the back gate, took her out through the parking lot where the used to be a laundry then. And she just went wild. She wanted just to go. And it was all they could do to wrestle her back into the garden and get the fence up again. And Emily said, Daddy, she needs to be free. She needs to be somewhere where she can roam. So then everybody said, well, who's gonna buy your donkey? And who's gonna buy a donkey cart? Well, we sold the donkey. Very quickly, we sold her to a woman who lived in Galway and raised horses. And apparently, if you put a donkey in with horses, it calms them. And a lot of people like to have a donkey in their herd of horses. And we found a woman who showed ponies, and she bought the pony cart, and that was the end. But I still occasionally will run into somebody about the age of Emily, you know, grown, Emmy's in her early 50s now. They'll say, oh, you're the ones who had the donkey. I used to ride that donkey. Well, of course, if we'd known that at the time, it would have been just awful.
Got a cleaner.
Yep.
Chinese cleaner. Tailor. Market. Both those paper where you used to get papers and magazines and stuff.
Yeah, Moon and River place. That used to be Mr. Vogel's. Well, he had papers and he had mainly confectionery, old-fashioned confectionery store, buy candies and stuff.
Well, then, and Barney had a big warehouse there. Mm-hmm. Then you had Kruger's across the street, another restaurant, Sam Hankins restaurant, my grandfather's barber shop. One was a lawyer, one was a bookie.
Yeah,
they were nice people. Mr. Faber, may he rest in peace. His feet were so bad.
people to raise dogs, and we had people that raise crops and wherever they had, and then some people just raise cane.
They used to deliver bread to the house.
Yeah. I still have one of the old Fred Offer signs. He put the sign in the window and he'd combine his cart and he'd stop him. The old guy was the great one, was Sammy, the fruit peddler.
Oh my God. Oh my God. Can I have more coffee, please? Oh my God. Remember him and his horse?
He used to have horses that were older than he was.
They were something. The kids would talk to him, and the other kids would run behind his wagon and steal from.
And then when the broom factory burned, I was the one who turned that one in. It was still in operation, and it was still making brooms for the United States Naval Academy. My husband went there, and he was so fascinated when he heard that. He went over and went through the factory, and they weren't turning out many brooms. And then when it went on the market, people came from all over the United States to buy the equipment and the machinery and all of it. And I was sleeping in the back bedroom in that house, and I woke up to the sound of flames. It was the sound of the crackling flames that woke me up. And so I called it in, and they came down with everything because they were worried about the other houses around. And it was after that that they sold it and built the condominiums.
And I remember we used to get all our meat at Arthur's. They had a great meat market there when, back in the 60s and 70s. And even when we didn't live in the stockade, we used to get all our meat there.
Arthur's Market, when we first came in 1964, had been there for a long time. We would sometimes go and shop there, and even before we moved 20 years later into the stockade. It was entirely a shop. There was no place to sit down. You could sit down outside. Eventually, Arthur, I think because of his son Peter, who inherited the Arthur's, I think Peter is the one who said, well, you really ought to put chairs and tables outside, and then people can sit down. And people loved to do that. And they would come, they'd be occupied all the time, all day long, people talking away.
But Arthur's was mostly groceries when I was young. It was not a sit-down place. It was all groceries, and he delivered.
Arthur's was very successful, and they had several things that they had that they don't have now. New York Times used to be the source for New York Times. So you go there on Sunday, and there would be 50 or 60 of these Times that cost quite a bit of money with their name on it. I mean, everybody had a name. He reserved all these New York Times for people. So it was a big business.
I never did steal any candy, but boy, there were some kids that were experts at it at Arthur's Market. But I always thought afterwards that he knew, but he didn't care. I always thought he'd let them do it. I would never do anything like that. I was terrified that I'd get caught. But Arthur was there all the time. God, he spent like 60, 70 years behind that counter.
Well, Arthur died, and Peter took over. And Peter, a really smart guy, said, okay, we're going to have people inside sitting down as well as outside. And he moved all the suds and soaps and cereals and everything into one side of the Arthur's and turned the other side into a sandwich counter kind of thing. And that went very well. And they would come and have lunch, and it thrived.
Amazingly, just a year after the association was founded, there was on the books a historic district in Schenectady. And of course, the story goes on. The idea of convincing the city council and the mayor, and we had a city manager at the time as well, and the corporation council, and all these people had to be convinced that they would make an official law that would protect this neighborhood. We held mass meetings. You know, the old courthouse and the big columned house on Union Street. And they had a big room on the second floor, which was an original lecture hall, I suppose. And we had meetings there, and we'd have hundreds of people would attend and and discuss this situation and this problem.
Wild deals.
Yeah. Well, there was a lot of debate about it. There were tons of letters to the editor in the paper all the time. When the ordinance was finally passed, the first thing the city had to do was establish a board of review, which is the Historic District Commission, still functioning. And they're the people who review your plans for what you want to do with your property.
And report back to the building inspector.
So the first chairman of that was appointed as Bill, went to Bill Milton, the general. Werner was on that board, on the first floor. And again, sparks flew. Now, there was right away there was a challenge. Now, there was a big house across, there's an empty lot across the street. And there was a magnificent Victorian home built there. The Lyons home. When he died, he willed it to the First Presbyterian Church. And the church didn't want it, so they sold it to St. George's. And St. George's said, well, we don't want it, but why don't we just get rid of it and we'll have a piece of land there in case we want to expand in the future.
St. George's, when we got here, had for a long time been under the care, tender loving care, of Father Kirby. And Father Kirby was very high Anglican, and he's the one who restored St. George's to its pristine late 18th, early 19th century condition. And he had a following of devoted ladies who really loved him. And he wore a cassock, and you know, he kept all the finery, he developed rituals for the church and got fine liturgical vestments and candelabra and censers that you could swing and smell up the place. Ours. And good music, very good music.
He was quite a dramatic individual. We used to watch, of course, when you were involved in the church and you were there every single Sunday for like many years, you used to see Father Kirby do these wonderful sermons with all these wonderful gestures. So we used to call them like the crucifixion jester, and then there was the Easter jester, and then there was this gesture. Well, we had names for all these gestures that he would do. We would put the gesture with the word, and we would really have it worked out so that we knew that if he was going to say risen, the arm would go up, or hell, the arm would go down.
And on the way out, Father Kirby was there at the door. And he saw me, and he took my hand, and he wouldn't let go. Oh, he said, oh, and you are? And I said who I was. And he said, oh, I'm so glad to see you. And what do you do? And I said, well, I teach at Union College. Oh, you know, oh, he was such an entrepreneur. But he was also very high church and very conservative, I mean, socially in every other way.
And then I became a member of the St. George's Choir, back when it was just an all-boys choir, young boys and older men. It was like three age groups, but they was all men. And Mrs. Braden went to St. George's Church. I'll never forget, we were having a rehearsal and Mr. Monks was conducting. It was always Thursday night. And Mrs. Braden walked in and sat down in the men's choir. Well, if you know anything about the old rules, you didn't do that. And he stopped the rehearsal and he said, Mrs. Braden, what are you doing? And she said, I'm going to join the choir. And he said, you can't. It's a man and boys choir. It is not for women. And she said, well, I'm sorry. This has got to change. We got to have women and men in this choir, and I'm staying. Well, she stayed for the rehearsal, but It was a big hoopla. I remember Father Kirby and everybody would be running around in circles because of this woman. And eventually they talked her out of joining the choir, but now they have what we would call an integrated choir, men and women.
And St. George's had a new priest named Father Kirby. And he moved into the area. And he was around recruiting for the church and got a lot of people to join the church. And he had this one person, an elderly person, that was donating substantial monies to the church. And she had a birthday coming up, and so he arranged for a big birthday party for her.
There was one morning when I looked out my kitchen window and saw the neck and head of a camel slowly walking down to the riverfront.
I had some people helping me in my house painting the side there, and I live in the lane which goes from Front Street down to the river. I said to the guys working on my house painting, I said, "Here come some camels down the street." Well, they thought I was off my rocker there. But when they walked by, they couldn't believe it, you know. Here's some camels going by.
Well, I learned that there was a party for a woman who had turned 100 years. And when she had been in the Middle East, she never had a chance to ride a camel. So to celebrate, they had quite an event with bagpipes pipes and the rest. And she indeed mounted the camel. And I thought, well, I don't know of any place where I would look out my kitchen window and see such things.
I have a suspicion that something my father did with the church was what prompted them to start it. The church owned or bought a piece of property in St. George's, right next door to Cranmer House. And at that time, Father Kirby was there, and he wanted to start a church school. And I think that was the plan. And they tore down a building. And of course, I think it was Werner and Jim, because of course they were right across the street. They tried to stop it. And I think my father was persona non grata here for quite a while. That's what I think. When I look back on it and when I remember it, I don't remember him ever really talking about it. But he was a church warden, I think, at the time. And yeah. So I think that's when they decided we've got to do something that gives us some clout when we want to stop a teardown.
Well, here we were. The ordinance was in place 2 months, and they were challenging it already.
And we fought it like hell.
And what a fight.
To stop it.
But we lost because the ordinance was too weak.
Yeah.
And I've collected photographs of lost stockade. And there were no... And the interesting thing is, no individual has ever destroyed a home. It's only the organizations, the churches, the club. Well, here's the building that the corner of Church and Front Street, all of them designed by Samuel Fuller. And it says, "The elegant Jeremiah Fuller Mansion, built in 1792, was located on the corner of Church and Front Streets, but was torn down for a parking lot in 1958, before the ordinance. Originally, it was the site of Adam Vroman's house and where he took the stance against the French and Native Indians in the 1690 massacre. Unfortunately, this is before preservation of the stockade was considered an alternative."
Yes, I didn't realize that at 19 Front, it was the site of where the French and Indians came in the gate and the massacre started, and where apparently a lot of the victims were buried. So The house has a history and not a very happy one.
But the houses here are quite unique, quite interesting, and fun. And we have an occasional ghost that shows up every once in a while. Now, I don't think I have a ghost in my house.
And one time I was down in the basement refinishing a desk, and I went down every night after dinner and worked on it and never thought a thing about it. It was a very old basement, that's an old house. And just all of a sudden one night, my hair just stood up, you know, prickly like that, and I just felt this horrible presence. And I fled, I didn't turn around and look, I just fled. And years later, when the Jeanettes were living there, Liz called me, and she said, you lived in that house once. Did you ever have any experience in the basement? And I said, I certainly did, and I told her about it, and she said, well, it chased me and my secretary out of the basement the other day. And she said, I don't go back now unless I have somebody with me. Oh, and the dog, Greg Sauer was walking with his dog when she was still quite young. And he said all of a sudden she got very agitated, and then he looked, he thought there was a squirrel or something. And he looked down and she was zeroed in looking at the basement windows at 19 Front. And her hair stood up so he could see it. And she was growling. And he, in fact, he said she was young enough he'd never heard her growl before. And they left, but she, as they left down the street, she backed up the whole way with her eyes on that spot.
But the place I lived at, North Ferry Street, I was convinced I had a ghost. I was sitting in the living room one night, and I looked out into the hall, and the light in the ceiling fell off the ceiling, and it didn't just fall down. It sort of floated down. It was the weirdest experience. It floated down and ended up on the floor, and I thought, well, it was a globe, and it should have broke. So I went over, and I picked it up, and I looked up at the fixture, and I thought, you know, this is me, just me being dramatic. So I got my little ladder out and I climbed up and I tried to put the light back in again and it wouldn't go in. Well, realizing the screws were all the way in. So I couldn't figure that out. So I didn't think much of it. I unscrewed it. I put the light back up. I screwed it back in again. And about a month later, the same thing happened. And then I used to get these like air going through this room, and I used to think it was my imagination, and I'm not sure I believe in ghosts, but something's going on in that house down on Washington, 11 North Church.
I went to Riverside School until I think the third grade, because I remember my older brother, who was 6'5", he walked me to his one step, I would take four steps, you know, he would take me up there.
I went to Riverside School, and that was a walking distance. We had classes of, they were all in the 30 to 35 per class bracket, yeah. But they were all from the neighborhood, yeah.
We'd come home, I'd come home for lunch, run home, because living so close for Riverside, and mostly all the kids did. And that was, yeah, there was a tremendous amount of traffic down here, people walking and around, and...
This place is interesting. The Riverside School is now a condominium where we're sitting. I first came to this building in the 1960s to WMHT. WMHT's original studio was in the basement.
Well, the school has changed a lot. I didn't mention that my wife was the first artist for WMHT, and Dorothy had a little studio in the basement.
I remember one of the first broadcasts of WMHT. I think we were given French lessons on TV.
I lived in that yellow house across the street, and it's ironic that I live in this building, because one of the, you know, there have been several fights down here in the Stockade. When I say fights, I mean conflict over what's going to be done to an historic building or something. And there are a lot of people who live down here who just love it because of what it is and it's nice. There are also a lot of us who live down here because in addition, we love the buildings and the history, and we're ready to fight for them. So it was a very sad day when they finally closed the school. Well, then we heard that a developer was coming in to do condominiums. Well, that's where the divide came in the stockade. A lot of people thought, oh, that's progress, it'll be wonderful, we're gonna have a condominium. And those of us who loved the school thought it was a very poor idea.
Because we thought that it would be more of a neighborhood to have children, or families come here with children. Blake Realty managed to buy it because they had the larger bid.
But then once it was done, we wanted this to be a success. I mean, we didn't want to look outside our window into an empty, boarded up building. And so I ended up where I had put a lot of work into fighting.
We had an opportunity to carry on a fight about that once. The house across the street, the big one that looks, you know, Princess Beatrix, who is now Queen of the Netherlands, came here and toured the stockade at one point. And Giles Vandenbogert was in a limousine with her, and he toured her through the neighborhood. And she was still a princess at the time, not a queen. And she, when she saw this house, where the professors live, two Union College professors, man and wife and their daughter, live across the street in this big house with a blue gable on the top. And when she passed that, she said, "This reminds me of home, the Netherlands." Oh. And sometime after that, the house caught fire during the night. And when the fire trucks came, because of all these wires in front, they couldn't get their aerial ladders up onto the building. So the building suffered tremendous damage. And luckily, the family that lived there had insurance, and it was all rebuilt again beautifully. But so when that happened...
Bavier.
Bavier's lived there, yeah. Okay. I wrote letters to the editor and so on about the danger of these overhead wires in the stockade, because they are preventing normal fire prevention. And nothing came of it, but we tried to fan it and make as big a story and get people excited about it. And then in 1973, the U.S. Department of the Interior entered the stockade on the National Register of Historic Places. So the job still isn't done, as you know.
For Giles, the architecture of the stockade district offered a live and vivid history of New York architecture from its earliest days. It held its interest for him, as it does for us, because it retains its vitality, because it is not an embalmed architecture like that of Williamsburg. It lives, and we live in it. It moves with a constantly changing life, its renewed creativity enhancing its historic charm.
Werner drew that cartoon of Indians sitting there and pointing to a colonial house and saying, you know, some damn newfangled style coming in. And that sort of sums the whole idea. And it's still debated when development takes place in an historic district. Must it look like the buildings that are there, or must it express its own time as all of those buildings that are? Look how different they all are. Each one expressed the time they were built. And so why should we say no to that?
Thank you.
My husband was the president of the association. He was on the board. I was on the board. What we found was that people who lived here had a goal, a kind of commitment, to be sure that this very special place would be on sound footing and not, well, decline as it once did. And people have devoted endless hours to working on our constitutions, bylaws, how do they serve us. So the purpose was asked of one of the founders, and the answer was, in case there are difficulties. And so, the actual stated mission is preservation, protection, and improvement. It's really been a wonderful place to live. I'm happy that this is where I have called my home for the greater part of my life.
I feel very privileged to own the house that I own, and the fact that I'm sort of taking care of it for the next person that's probably going to own it and enjoy it, because it's a lot of fun to live in it. Because it's just different. There hardly a day goes by when I don't open my door. Of course, now it's cold, so it's not going to happen in the winter, where somebody isn't taking a picture of your house. So you always look, and you always ask where they're from. And the interesting thing is they're from all over. But it's amazing how many people come through here. I'm not sure that the city actually realizes the amount of tourism that we could create here, or have here actually, because of the stockade. And there are people that actually drive here to look at the houses, and we kind of take it for granted because we live here, but there's people walking on the streets all the time, but they come from all over to see the homes, to see the exterior of the homes, and they really are, they're interesting. And as I said, I think we take that whole thing for granted, the wonderful place we live in. It's quite unique.
Really, the place is endlessly interesting. So what we have to offer is a quality of life here that will attract homeowners who will care for these buildings, historic buildings that need a lot of attention through the years.
And thank God that Fibus and Schmidt and Van de Bogart and a bunch of other people had the foresight to save it. And that's really what they did. They saved it from the wrecking ball, because I don't think it probably would have been here if those people hadn't got together.
It floated down and ended up.